Macmillan Audio presents Biting the Hand, Growing Up Asian in Black and White America. Written and read for you by Julia Lee. For My Mother and Father. Part 1. Rage. Chapter 1. Angry Little Asian Girl. When I was in graduate school in the early 2000s, I took an intensive Latin course over the summer to fulfill my foreign language requirement. I was 26 years old and had just finished my first year of the PhD program in English at Harvard University. It had been a rough year, full of crushing self-doubt about whether I belonged in graduate school at all. That summer, I lived on the first floor of an old Victorian house with no air conditioning and a mouse problem that I discovered only after finding tiny turds in my toaster oven. Every morning, I walked the 20 minutes to campus to join a class of about 15 students, mostly college kids and grad students like me trying to pass their language exams. Our instructor was a balding white guy in his late 20s who was finishing up his doctoral degree in classics and fancied himself an amateur comedian. For 3 hours a day, he marched us through Wheelock's Latin, tossing in bad jokes when our attention flagged. One day, in the middle of a lesson, he cracked a joke that ended with a punchline about a dog, canis, the only Latin word I still remember, being taken to the back of a Korean restaurant and eaten. The class laughed, and I felt myself turn hot with anger and shame. I was the only Asian person in the class. I did not smile even after the teacher made eye contact with me and I saw his face tighten. Shit, I forgot there was an Asian student in here. I went home that day in a fury. I confided in some of my friends who assured me I wasn't overreacting. The joke was racist, period. It never crossed my mind to confront the teacher. He was grading me, and I really, really needed to pass the class. Instead, I went passive-aggressive. I put on my bright red, angry little Asian girl t-shirt and wore it to class the next day. On the front of my shirt was a cartoon of a scowling Asian girl, both her middle fingers raised. I bought the t-shirt earlier that year after stumbling across the Angry Little Asian Girl series online. Created by Leela Lee in 1994 while she was a student at Berkeley, the comic attacked the model minority myth, that hackneyed stereotype that Asian Americans are quiet, passive, acquiescent. Because Angry Little Asian Girl was, quote, small and relatively cute, Lee wrote, people assumed she'd be sweet and polite. They were wrong. She was full of rage. She fought with her parents, clapped back at microaggressions, and swore a lot. The comic was a cult hit in the Asian American community. But when Lee tried to bring the series to television, she was told by network execs that her proposed show was, quote, too racially charged, and that Asians weren't a strong enough consumer market. Apparently, Angry Little Asian Girl was too angry, too little, and too Asian. In retrospect, putting on the t-shirt was a dumb way to protest, but it was the only way I could tell my teacher, fuck you. Oddly enough, he got the message. Maybe it was my t-shirt, or maybe it was my death stare, but after class, he asked me to stay for a few minutes and apologized for his offensive joke. I could tell he wanted me to say it was no big deal, but I could barely look him in the eye. Walking to a coffee shop on Mass Ave afterwards to get started on that day's Latin homework, I realized I was still trembling with anger. I did not forgive him. He had apologized only because he had gotten caught. I trace my birth as an angry little Asian girl to the dawn of puberty. I hit adolescence at the same time my mother hit menopause. It's the late 80s in Los Angeles, and while my parents worked long hours, I spent my time watching MTV music videos and calling in requests for George Michael and Terrence Trent D'Arby from our landline. This was the era of sky-high bangs, hammer pants, and Jordan high tops, none of which my mom would let me have. Between the two of us and our raging hormones, there were screaming fights, some of them physical. I remember being 11 or 12 and talking back to my mom. Maybe I wouldn't practice the piano. Maybe I swore at her. And cowering in the laundry room as she pounded on the door with a rubber hose. Another time, she threw a full bottle of Sunny Delight at me. It missed me, landed on the floor, and exploded. She had a visceral hatred for our television set. We watched an appalling amount of TV while she and my father were at work. So she tried to smash the television set multiple times, finally busting it in such a way that no matter how hard my younger sister and I tried, we could only get black and white static. My parents immigrated to the United States from Korea in the early 1970s. My dad had come here as a student, my mom as a nurse. But 20 years later, they were now toiling at a fast food restaurant called Pioneer Chicken, trying to sell enough wings and biscuits to stave off bankruptcy. My mom was less than 5 feet tall and never topped 100 pounds, yet I was physically frightened of her, even after I outgrew her. Her rage was incandescent. She was in her 40s, stuck in an unhappy marriage, working long hours at a restaurant where employees stole from the register and customers threw corn on the cob in her face. The country was sliding into a recession, business was shitty, and now her oldest daughter was rebelling. The irony is that everyone, and I mean everyone, thought my mom was absolutely adorable. I would watch strangers approach her and ask if she was Miyoshi Umeki, the Academy Award-winning Japanese actress who starred in Sayonara and Flower Drum Song. For years, I assumed this was a case of white people thinking all Asians look alike. But then I saw a photo of Umeki and gasped. She was a dead ringer for my mom, with the same pixie haircut, round cheeks, and impish smile. My mom knew how to turn on the charm around strangers, usually white people, but also fellow Koreans. Partly, it was about saving face. Called chaemyeon, this code of behavior is common to many East Asian cultures and values harmony and honor. It's a kind of social armor. You might be broke or unemployed or depressed, but you cosplayed prosperity and success. For some Koreans, that meant driving luxury cars, even if you couldn't afford the payments, or mimicking a happy marriage, even if your husband was beating you, or bragging about your kids' straight A's, even if they were suicidal. For my mother, chaemyeon meant being decorous and polite in public, even when she was filled with roiling anger in private. It was far too shameful to reveal the truth behind the facade. To the outside world, we were a model minority family, quiet, undemanding, hardworking. But on the inside, we were falling apart. Around this time, my father suffered a freak accident at work while trying to fix a broken oven. An employee had put a large pot of water to boil on the stovetop, and my dad jostled it while working on the oven underneath. The pot was a relic, with a bottom so warped it was more rounded than flat. It capsized onto my father, drenching him in scalding water. Despite the pain, my father dried himself off, changed his shirt, and kept working until closing time. Only then did he take himself to the emergency room, where he was diagnosed with first and second degree burns all over his face and body. At first, my mother didn't tell us what happened, lying and saying that my dad was asleep in their room. We knew something was up, though, because the door was always locked and he never came out, not even for meals or work. And soon, we were certain he was dying or already dead. When my mother finally let us in, my father was lying in bed, his body wrapped in gauze like a mummy. Half of his face and neck had been burned off, as well as most of his torso, and he was covered in raw pink ulcers that would later turn crusty and black. The room reeked of ointment. My sister and I cried, unable to hug him because the pressure was far too painful. In that moment, I felt anguish, but also blooming shame. I tacitly understood we were not to mention my father's accident to anyone. It was too private. Too grotesque. To our friends and acquaintances, we kept mum. Not long after, my father returned to work. He had to. My mother couldn't run the restaurant by herself. He returned to Pioneer Chicken with a bandaged face, visibly marred to any customer who came in. "What happened?" people asked him. "An accident," my dad would shrug. My father was stoic, saving face even when his face was literally disfigured. Watching him, I felt my own face contort, trying to suppress a rage I did not yet understand. I had always found refuge in school. I was an excellent student, eager to please and starved for the affirmation I didn't get at home. I was the kind of kid who diligently sharpened my pencils every night and joyfully picked out new binders and notebooks at the beginning of the school year. I dreaded weekends, two whole days stuck at home with no friends, no teachers, just my unhappy family. When I was 12, I started attending a private all-girls school located in a wealthy LA neighborhood straight out of a John Hughes movie. In fact, Pretty in Pink was shot at a nearby mansion. My father balked at the tuition, but my mother insisted that they could make it work by practicing extreme frugality, cutting back on things like clothes, food, and health insurance. Driving through the neighborhood for the first time, I marveled at the wide streets, the stately Tudor homes, the massive lawns, so different from the shabby dingbat apartment buildings and bungalows in my own neighborhood. In my secondhand uniform, salvaged from the school's lost and found, and my saddle shoes purchased two sizes too big to last longer, I felt like an imposter and a clown. My new school was cloistered and conservative, a legacy of its origins as a finishing school for the daughters of LA's white Protestant elite. Though it had since rebranded itself as a college prep school dedicated to empowering young women, it still clung to antiquated rituals like mother-daughter luncheons, father-daughter dances, and graduation ceremonies where girls wore white debutante dresses and carried bouquets. Of course, I didn't know any of this at the time. My mother just told me the school was for smart girls and that I was lucky to get in. Over the next 6 years, my gratitude would sour into resentment and then a helpless rage. Where I had once been a teacher's pet, I soon developed a reputation for having a bad attitude and a problem with authority. Unlike my parents, I couldn't control my face in public. When Julia participates in class, she makes it clear she wishes she were anywhere else, one teacher wrote on my report card. Another noted, Julia has a negative attitude, but I am sadly getting used to it. I was called a wild card, someone who wasn't a team player. No one, it seemed, could understand why I acted this way. Not my parents, not my teachers, not my classmates. What did I have to be so angry about? In eighth grade, a year into my new school, my English class spent the year reading autobiographies and then writing our own personal essays. It's a familiar assignment to anyone who's been in an intro English class, a seemingly straightforward way for teacher and student to get to know each other. The overarching theme for the year was coming of age. Who were we? What was our identity? How were we transforming from girls into young women? My teacher was a pear-shaped white woman with brown teeth and frizzy hair named Mrs. Church. Mrs. Church's favorite thing to tell me was, take a chill pill. That year, I was obsessed with the TV show American Gladiators and went to a taping at Universal Studios with my friends, where I screamed my undying love for Nitro from the bleachers. I was so extra, so emotional, so hyper, basically an average 13-year-old girl. I'd always loved reading, but eighth grade was the year I discovered I loved writing. In particular, I loved writing about things that made me angry, which encompassed everything from my algebra teacher to the Ku Klux Klan, which was the topic of my final research paper. We had read Charlotte Bronte's Jane Eyre that year, and I could easily identify with Jane's rebelliousness. The novel traces the life of Jane, a young orphan, from a miserable childhood living with her aunt and cousins, to her grim education at a charity school, to her employment as a governess in the household of a brooding master. For the narrator Jane, writing her autobiography allowed not only a measure of release, but also a measure of revenge. Jane might have been, quote, poor, obscure, plain, and little, but she was also an angry little English girl. Writing Jane Eyre was how she got back at everyone who had wronged her, her mean Aunt Reed, her stupid cousin John, the tyrannical schoolmaster Mr. Brocklehurst, even the manipulative Rochester. I wrote two autobiographical essays for Mrs. Church that year. Both were filled with rage. But only one got a positive response. The first essay was about being Korean-American and how I felt torn between my parents' culture.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, Use the link in the video description.